Thank you so much for your warm welcome. It's my great pleasure to be here with you, and thank you so much to the Thai Ministry of Education, to the TCU project, and all the universities who are organizing such a big and important event about imagining the future of MOOCs. Give us a big applause for our kind organizers and conference. I'm here for the second time. I was here 10 years ago, and that was on behalf of another conference here in Bangkok. And that was just the start of the TCU, the Thai Cyber University project. And I'm very impressed to listen and to see what happened during the last 10 years. It's my great pleasure to also recognize how Thai is taking a leading position in the MOOC development. You may see some of the pictures from 10 years ago, and I'm very curious how Bangkok looks like in our days. I hope that I can explore tomorrow. I'd like to speak now to you about the quality and the future of open education and MOOCs. And I have prepared a lot of slides. This is my style, I'm sorry for that. Of course, you can get the slide afterwards. You can look on them, you can even share them, and also use them in the future according to that open license. Please, this is my kind request to you, always put such an open license on everything that you are producing, that you are sharing, that everybody knows what you can do with that. Have a look on SlideShare as well as on the conference website, you will find everything there. Thanks to the kind chairman and chairwoman, they have already introduced myself. I'm with the Open University of the Netherlands, even though that I'm German. I'm also very pleased to be with the Korean National Open University and the East China Normal University. And I'm very happy that I was appointed as ICDE Chair in Open Educational Resources. My experiences, I'm combining business as well as academia. I have done a lot of international projects in the fields of e-learning, and I have set up my own research institute in Germany, leading up to 11 researchers in the end. My interests are higher education, but also in particular school education. I will tell you in a minute why. I strongly believe that we have also to improve school education. And please let us discuss a little bit how this can happen in the future, also with the involvement of MOOCs. Well, to give you a short overview of the project, it's impossible. You can find more information on these websites, and this is just a selection, and I'm very happy also to meet you in the lunch break and in the afternoon to discuss more about that. Okay, let's start. Good morning. Good morning. Great. I'd like to give you a very short introduction on the current situation, because you all know what is happening at the moment. We have the digital age. Everybody with you is with a smartphone, with a computer, and so on. I don't have to tell you about that. And we have internationalization. That's why I'm so happy to see all of you here from so many different universities and countries and even continents here. And we have one common challenge, that is learn how to learn, because we cannot predict what will happen in 10 years. And if we look backwards, there was always a balance. Everything started with the commons. Everything was free. Everything was openly available. Afterwards, states and countries were established. I'm talking now about thousands of years backwards. And in our days now, private business is becoming more and more important. But what is happening with the education? How can we get back to that balance? We have to consider how is learning fitting into that framework. How we can facilitate good learning in our current digital age. We have to recognize it's learning in a global crisis. And we have several crises. We have an economic crisis. We have an education crisis. We have a media crisis. And we have societal crisis. And that's underlying, again, the importance of learning and education. We need innovations and we need high quality in learning education for our own future and our own society. There are learning challenges, but also learning changes. And we have to move from the wonderful it's maybe better here. It's a wonderful tool, but I have to do it here. We have to move here from the input to the outcome. Now, you see what I mean, to the outcome. And this is a paradigm shift that has also to happen with our education. 10 years ago, I was pleased to visit the impressive Buddha statue. And this is also giving a feeling how Asia is facing the current challenges in learning and education. It's very good to see that you also put patience, but also dedication into your current situation. And I think this is a very good advice for all of us worldwide. And luckily, we have also the Sustainable Development Goals approved by the United Nations. And the fourth one is promoting inclusive and equitable quality education and requiring lifelong learning for all. But what is quality education? And now I start a tour with you. Please don't be shocked. I will run now through all the following slides. And please tell me if it's too quick. I can interrupt at any time, as long as not too many are raising their hand. And I will also be happy to answer your questions. What is quality education? And I would like to start with an experiment. I'm from the university, I'm a researcher, I have to do experiments, you know, okay, that's the business. Okay, let's have a look. A simple experiment. Imagine and define the quality of your favorite gummy bear. Do you have any ideas? And to make it a little bit easier for you, I have prepared something with me. And please think about your answers. You have 2 taste them, and then it's hopefully also. Please give him through the. I have more also for the last rows, of course. Oh, you here. Okay. Please give them. And give them through the lines. Okay, I'm listening to your answers. How do you find the quality of your favorite gummy bear? Florsius. Are you still waiting for the gummy bears? Yeah? Yeah? The answer is according to the age. Okay, yeah? 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 That means we have to have several answers from different ages. What is your answer? tasty. Oh, the taste is most important for the quality. Okay, yeah. Good for health. Okay, yeah. Even so that they are from my hometown, that's why I'm always bringing them with me, I'm not that sure that they are good for health, but I didn't want to disappoint you. Any other cons? Yeah? Colorful but not enough. Okay. I'm sorry, I was not expecting so many people, but my hand luggage was limited. I'm very sorry about that. Well, actually, I forgot my device over there. Actually, all your answers are not only valuable, but they are also all correct. Because quality cannot be defined. Even so, my answer would be yellow, because that is my favorite taste in the gummy bears that I'm bringing with me. But quality cannot be defined except through adaptation to your situation and your specific context. That means everybody has a different taste, a different preference, a different perspective. That has to be recognized not only in the choice of gummy bears, but also in education and training. And I would like to start with a statement. We need change in education. And I'd like to convince you now, during the following 20 minutes, why we need change in education and which kind of change we need. To improve the quality of in education, that is the overall objective and target. Okay, let's have a look. What is it, quality of learning, education, and training? First of all, I'd like also to highlight the very first standard from ISO, the International Standardization Organization, for the quality of learning, education, and training. It is ISO IEC 40180. It consists of 7 process categories, and 38 processes are belonging to that. And that is the very first ISO standard for the learning quality that was already developed and published in the year 2005 and revised in the year 2017. And also for that international ISO standard, there is the same truth. You have to adapt that. It's not a standard that's fitting for all, but you have to adapt. And you can see here now that you have to select the processes. You have to select the processes that are relevant for your specific situation and to define them according to your requirements and needs. Okay, let me remind you again on the topic and the title of my speech, the quality and future of open education and MOOCs. And I'm diving now into the details. But first I have to answer the question, what is open education? Yeah, if you remind me. Quality and future of open education and MOOCs, what is open education? Well, open education, open means a lot. There are so many dimensions of openness. And I started a few years ago to scientifically distinguish different dimensions and categories of openness. But what I'd like to highlight is that it's most important that openness is much more than open access. It's much more than open licenses. You have always to think about how to enable open education through resources, through technologies, but also with open visions, with open innovations and open strategies. My short answer on what is open education is, open education is innovating and changing education to improve the quality, the learning quality. And to give you a short background about open education. The waves of open education started in the 60s last century with open classrooms and open universities, and then there were several waves of open education. I cannot tell you all about that, but we are very happy that the open universities are also one of the first movements and first drivers of open education. But we have also to think about the wonderful pedagogical innovators like Paul Freire and many others. And it's so amazing what happened already 50, 60 years ago. And then we have the open educational resources, we have the open online collaboration, we have open education practices, and now maybe open learning environments. But we have always to keep in mind that is based on innovations in learning and pedagogy that is happening already since hundreds, since thousands of years. Think about Confucius, think about Socrates in Asia and in Europe. Think about movements in Russia, in Europe, in America. There are so many pedagogies, so many educators that has already invented innovations in learning education that is not completely new. That's why I'd like to end with a scientific definition what open education means. And it is always focusing on the learning quality. Combining and overarching all the different perspectives of openness. And how can we achieve open education? There are a lot of different ways how to opening up education. And I just would like to pick up something here that is also crucial. Involve your management. It's so important that you also get support from your management. You can do a lot by yourself, but you're getting much stronger if you connect with your colleagues and you have this full support from your management. And then it's also good to go beyond, outside of your network, outside of your organization, and to share with the world. And think about, you make the difference. Okay, I said we need change in education. I hope that I could at least convince you a little bit that there is such a need. And I also hope that I could convince you that we need open quality education. And I'd like also to highlight, we need open quality education with fun. Don't forget the fun. What about your pupils, your students? Yeah? They can sleep. I hope you're not sleeping. Okay. Okay, and then let's start into the question, what is open quality education? We have now clarified what is open education. Now, what is open quality education? I hope that you have already an idea how quality can be defined, not only through the gummy bears, but maybe also thanks to the gummy bears. And if we talk about quality in education, then we have the quality development as the umbrella. The total quality management approach was also invented here in Asia. And we have to distinguish between processes, results, and potential. This distinction of the three dimensions was invented in the healthcare sector by Donabedian in the 1980s. And we have transferred that into the fields of open education. And then we are talking about realizations, achievements, and objectives that you have to address. And we have also developed several strategies and tools, frameworks, how to introduce that. The IDEA framework is one of them. And we have also tools and frameworks how to measure the impact that we are achieving. And the EFI framework is also one of them. And This is leading us to the OpenEd framework that is transferring and adapting all the three dimensions on the three different levels, the micro, the meso, and the macro level, for the individual learners, the organizations, and the educational systems and societies. And let me just answer a short question on site before I'm diving into the MOOCs, because this is also related to the MOOCs. What are open educational resources? Open educational resources are well recognized by UNESCO with the two World OER Congresses. Last one was in 2017 in Ljubljana. And MOOCs are, and that's why I just mentioned open educational resources, a kind of open educational resources. There's a long debate, are MOOCs open educational resources or not? We have just finished a new article to be published in 1 month, together with Stephen Downs and other colleagues, about this question, and you will find that in the references, and I would also be happy to listen to your opinions about that. What are MOOCs? MOOCs are massive open online courses. Full stop. Easy, isn't it? Yeah, but you can see a lot of question marks here. Behind each of the terms, you can find a question mark, and that is intentionally, of course, put there, because MOOCs are not massive, not all. Most of them are not open anymore. Sometimes behind paywalls or registrations, or you have to register for the certificate and so on. Some of them are not even online, and then you have also some MOOCs or something that is called a MOOC that is not even a course. But we have to say they are coming and we cannot stop them. They are already among us, and we have also MOOCs here in Asia, and I was very pleased that 1 year ago I could evaluate 3 media literacy MOOCs here in Malaysia, in Vietnam, and also here in Thailand. And I was very impressed about not only the quality of the MOOCs, but also, in particular, the platform, the national initiatives that are taking place here in Asia, much different from Europe. What is the future of MOOCs? Already in the year 2012, Daniel said, oh, it's an educational buzzword. And I wrote an article in 2017, MOOCs are dead, and long live the MOOCs, because I strongly believe in the MOOCs. But we have to go back to the original intention. Massive, open, online courses. Yeah? This is most important. The current status of MOOCs, they are still growing. In numbers, in students, in organizations that are providing them. The average of students in one MOOC is going down, but that's only due to the fact that more and more MOOCs are provided and repeated and so on. There are much more opportunities of MOOCs in our days now. But what about the quality of MOOCs? And here, this is my point. Most MOOCs are looking like the same. They are just watch a video, continue, make a quiz. And that's all. And that is not sufficient. The quality debate started with a high dropout rate. But my belief is, and that's why I wrote another article, we need higher dropout rates. We need higher dropout rates in MOOCs. Why should we have higher dropout rates in MOOCs? The intentions and the personal goals of the participants in MOOCs are quite different. Everybody is coming to a MOOC with own perceptions and with own intentions. And most of them just want to have a look. What is the latest literature? What has changed? How this MOOC is designed? How it looks like? And after 10 minutes, latest 1 hour, they are gone. They are not coming back anymore. And I say, they are successful. They have exactly done what they have planned. They wanted to go into the MOOC, have a sneak peek, watch it for 10 minutes, 1 hour maximum, and everything is done. They are counted as a dropout, and for that reason I say we need higher dropout rates, because we have also to reflect that there is a huge difference in personal intentions. And this has also to be reflected by the MOOC designers. For that reason, we started MOOC, but MOOC with a Q. Q for? Yes, quality, yeah. And we are saying we will make MOOCs better. That is our promise. And I've prepared a short video about MOOC that you get a short introduction what MOOC stands for. Yep, if you can start the video. And that is the key result, the quality reference framework, QRF. We've done it in close collaboration with all MOOC learners and designers worldwide. And we are happy to offer it to you. Thank you. And what we have done, that was mixed method research. We contacted a lot of MOOC learners, designers, facilitators, and providers through a combination of different research instruments. The Global MOOC Quality Survey, coded expert interviews. We had a lot of workshops in interaction with all the participants, and communication and collaboration in any kind of media. The Global MOOC Quality Survey was also started in cooperation with many, many international organizations, including UNESCO, IITE, ITC, ILO, UNITAR, ICDE, COL, and many others. And I just want to highlight the key result from the Global MOOC Quality Survey. We had several hundreds of participants, and we have compared the MOOC learners and the MOOC designers. And the key finding was on the interaction. We have distinguished between 4 different interactions. The interaction between learners and facilitators, learners and resources, and groups among themselves. And you can see that on the left hand side, you see the results for the learners, and they really appreciate and value the 3 different interactions, at least. On the right-hand side, you see the results from the MOOC designers, and you can see the MOOC designers does not value the interaction types. And that means there's a huge gap between the expectations from the MOOC designers and the preferences from the learners. And we would like to close that gap. And for that reason, we have developed the Quality Reference Framework. The Quality Reference Framework includes 3 dimensions, and in the annex, you have also 2 adaptations. one for MOOC beginners and one for MOOC experts. The quality checklist for beginners, simple questions that you can answer just to make sure that you have thought about everything if you design a MOOC for the very first time. And the quality indicator list, this is a very, very long list for the MOOC expert to find out whether you have thought about any potential quality aspect. And the three dimensions that are the faces, the perspectives, and the roles. And for the faces, we distinguish between the analysis, design, implementation, realization, and evaluation. That sounds familiar. It's, of course, based on the ISO standards that I've just mentioned a few minutes ago, ISO IEC 40180, but also it is in line with many other design principles like ADDIE or others that you know. Perspectives. We have to think about different perspectives, the pedagogical perspective, the technological perspective, and the strategic perspective. What is your objective? What you'd like to achieve with your MOOC? And finally, we have also to distinguish between different roles, because there are always different responsibilities, and there are designers, facilitators, and providers that have to do different things in the development of a MOOC. It's freely and openly available. You can download it, you can share it. Of course, there's an open license on it. You can even adapt it to your specific needs. I was very happy to hear already the request, oh, I have heard about your quality reference framework. Is this possible to get it? It's not possible to get it. It's possible just to download and to adapt it, to change it. Please have a look. We have the open license on it, and we are very happy if you not only read it, but if you use it. And I'd like to kindly invite you this afternoon into room 211. I will explain much more in detail what the quality reference framework is about. And in particular, I'd like also to show you and to answer your question about the different dimensions and the two adaptations for MOOC beginners and MOOC experts. You're most welcome. Okay, and let's come back to the question how to address learning in the global crisis that I've mentioned before. We have the concept of lifelong learning. That means we are not finishing learning after finishing school or after finishing university. We have to learn from a baby up to our seniorship. And we have sometimes to learn only small pieces of information nuggets. But sometimes we have built big and complex competences, horizontal key competences, like learning to learn or critical thinking, your own learning strategies. And of course, there are the different modes of learning, formal, non-formal, and informal. The question is now, what do we do most in our current situation? And even more important is, what do we need most to ensure high quality learning and education for all? I was reminded to a speech that was one of my very first keynote speeches in the year 2007 in Bogota, and that was also on lifelong learning through digital learning and digital media. And I was impressed by the participation of 6,000 participants, strongly supported by the National Ministry of Education. And then, 2 years later, I was invited here to a conference on lifelong learning again in Thailand. And I was also very pleased to note the strong support by the Thai Ministry of Education, not only in our days, but already 10 years ago. And that made me think about the last question. What do we need most for all? I'm coming from Germany. I'm with the Open University of the Netherlands. I can say that in Europe, we are behind. We are behind Asia. We are behind also other regions of the world in relation to the strong support by our national government. It is now changing, but just starting. That's why please be aware that you have the privilege living here in a region that is valuing learning education strongly and make the best out of that. And that's why I'm very happy that IEC 2019 is happening here also with the opening by the Ministry of Higher Education. Okay, what can we do and offer to you? What is our research focus and how we could also collaborate in the future? I would like to give you a short answer on that in another video, please.
We are the Welton Institute. We are researchers in academic education who believe in co-creation. We not only conduct research on education, we do this with education. Together with our partners, we investigate real-life questions and problems in education. By taking practice as our starting point and science as our instrument, we ensure that our results apply to not just one, but to all schools, so that we can improve education together. We're experts when it comes to learning. How do people learn? And how do you make learning efficient, effective, and enjoyable? We're also experts when it comes to professionalization. How do you motivate teachers? How do you design the optimal working environment for them to work and learn together? And we're experts when it comes to technology. What are the possibilities of new educational technologies, and how can these be implemented effectively and efficiently? Every year, we publish many scientific articles, and we collaborate with other institutions, both national and international. We combine our expertise with years of experience from our own university, our partners, and our students in educational sciences. In addition to this, PhD students from all over the world participate in our research program. Everything converges at the Welton Institute. We advise, develop, implement, support, and research for you. Are you struggling to solve an education-related issue? Do you want to improve education but don't know where to start? We're eager to tackle complex challenges. Together with you, we analyze your problem, investigate your practices, and make changes so that we can improve education together.
Thank you. And what we have done in the past, I'd like to give you a very short introduction. That is starting with offering and facilitating open access for all. Two scientific open education resources. We started also with the very first harvesting platform with the Food and Agriculture Organization from the United Nations. And after 3 years, I was very surprised. We simply harvested the leading 17 repositories worldwide, and we came up with 17 million of open education resources only in the fields of agriculture. That means there's so much outside in the world. Just have a look and you can find a lot. And we are also doing a lot in relation to inclusive learning for all. We had one of the pilot projects here, EBOSMOSI. We have also a focus on learning how to learn as one of the key horizontal competences. And we believe that we have to strengthen new innovative pedagogy. Actually, they are not new. Problem-based learning is very, very old. But we have to facilitate that in our schools and in our universities, we will have much more flipped classrooms, much more flipped pedagogies in the future than in the past. And for that reason, we have developed that we are calling ODEAR. ODEAR. ODEA stands for the teachers, design, experiment, analyze and rethink. But also for the pupils, discover, explore, apply and reflect. And we believe that this cycle that has to be an iterative cycle in agile learning, rapid learning, it has to be repeated many, many times, and you have always to go back to the beginning to find out whether you can still improve it and to have a better quality in the next one. And let me remind you on the Open Ed framework for the quality of open education, and then you can also combine that with the ideal framework for the introduction of that open education, with the ODEA framework related to introducing flipped classrooms and flipped pedagogies, and you can also measure how that is achieving impact. Okay, and as I said, my personal interest is in school education. Open school education is most important for me. We have had open discovery space involving more than 2,500 schools. We have trained more than 40,000 teachers and provided more than 800,000 OERs. We have had inspiring science education for the STEM, science, technology, engineering and mathematics education in schools. And we have now open STEM learning as a follow-up on pedagogical models for new science focus. And this is how it can look like. This is a school. You don't see any classroom anymore. There are no teachers anymore. This is the new way how school education can be organized. And we are very proud that we are collaborating and doing common research with such leading schools. This is an example from the Netherlands, but you can find much more schools in other regions. How can you contribute? Simply publish and share your content, reuse existing content and connect to your colleagues, always use an open license. We have the iCore community. Please have a look and join our community. We have established several workshops for all, together with Open Education Consortium, Creative Commons and UNESCO, IITE. You can also become, of course, a student, PhD student in our university, and we have also a workshop titled MOOCs with Moodle that will happen at the OE Global 2019 in Milano soon. And finally, I'd like to invite you to the LINK conference, and this is something from the last years. I cannot show you everything, but I'd like maybe to give you a very short video, about 30 seconds for the last teaser, if you don't mind. And this is your kind invitation to join us this year in November. We believe school education is making the biggest impact for our future citizens. And we have to do that with innovative schools, with innovative teachers. And we would like to address the question, how can school education have a look in the future? Okay, thank you so much. And if you would like to learn more about the quality and future of open education and MOOCs, it is already taking place. We need change, and open education is not only a vision, but happening, and it is about inclusion and equity for all to improve our global society. You can find more references and more references and more references and more references in the following slides. Here are my contact data, and I'd like to close with my kind offer and my kind request. Please let us all collaborate together to improve the future quality education. Thank you so much.
Wow, thank you so much, Tony Stark. No. Christian Stark, for your very interesting presentation. A lot of links we have already tried to catch up with you and uploaded on our conference board. We haven't got a question in here, and we are a little bit behind on time. This afternoon, Dr. Stark will also feature in one of our concurrent sessions. So if you have any more questions, grab him during lunch or in his session. So ladies and gentlemen, without further delay, please join me to thank him. Thank you so much. And thank you for the jelly as well.
Thank you. And if you cannot remember, I have a gift with me. I will just distribute it. And you can also send this message, let us make MOOCs better, to your friends and your colleagues. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Let's make MOOC better. All right.
Next, we will have a coffee break. And since our schedule is a bit behind, so we will have 10 minutes break. So we will come back at 10:58, and you can bring your coffee break and have it in this conference room. We already get allowance from the organizer. So please enjoy the break and see you at 10:58. Thank you.